I'm Bruce Bugbee, president of Apogee Instruments, and I'd like you in this next couple minutes introduce Apogee's new four-component net radiometer to you. Now this, here it is, this is something we've been thinking about for 20 years. In my whole career, I've been thinking about ways to more accurately measure and model net radiation. And then, 4 years ago, we started a project to build an improved net radiometer. It's not been a trivial task, but we're excited to introduce this to the world. So I'm going to give you about a 30-second review of how we got to this point. We started 7 or 8 years ago testing all of the net radiometers available on the market at the time in the field. This is a picture of Mark Blomquist, the chief scientist at Apogee, out precision leveling these radiometers, cleaning them, all to make sure we have good data. To be sure we had it right, we bought triplicates of each of 5 types of instruments to evaluate their accuracy in the field. What we found from this was the 2 types of net radiometers that could separately measure the 4 components of net radiation were by far the most accurate. And in this picture, they're shown here as the Kipp and Zonen. This is a CNR1. This has now been upgraded to the CNR4, and the Hukseflux, which is here. And if we look hard in here, you can see triplicates of all these sensors on this mass. We ran this all summer long, collected an enormous body of research, and concluded if we're going to do a good job in net radiation, we need a 4-component instrument. Now, this work was published here, and you can pause this and get the paper, you can get it on the Apogee website, Accuracy of Net Radiometers. So, what does our instrument look like? Here's a picture of it, and you might think this is life-size because these instruments have historically been big, and after a lot of work, we were able to reduce the size and weight of this instrument. So we're quite proud of being able to do this because it makes it far easier to mount and to use. Let's take a look at what the 4 components really mean in this big picture. This little dome here is for shortwave radiation, which Apogee has spent the whole 20 years of the company precisely measuring shortwave. So we start with the sun, always smiling. This is shortwave in. You also need to measure shortwave reflected, and that's what this bottom is. These are the 2 components of the 4. Then we have longwave radiation from the sky coming in here, measured here, and longwave radiation from the soil here. That's a 4-component net radiometer, 4 separate measurements coming out to the instrument. Let's take a look at the state of the art for net radiation, and this is exemplified by 2 instruments. The first one is the Kipp and Zonen CNR4. Now, it has the same components, shortwave in and out, longwave in and out, and the Hukseflux NR01, shortwave in and out, longwave in and out. These instruments are bigger, heavier, and more expensive than the newer Apogee net radiometer. There's 2 other very significant differences between the Hukseflux and the Kipp and Zonen and the Apogee. Because net radiometers have a lot of outputs, they take up a lot of channels on a data logger. Here's a classic CR1000 data logger made by Campbell Scientific. If we hook either one of these instruments up to it, we have a bunch of wires that look like this. Now let's look at these wires and where they go on this diagram. These are the analog channels. We have shortwave radiation that comes into one. We have shortwave radiation out. This is incoming, this is out. These are 2 more channels. Long wave in, 2 channels. Long wave out, 2 more channels. Now we're out of channels on the top, and we haven't measured the reference temperature yet. That is a platinum resistance thermometer for the reference. And to make accurate measurements of that, we need two differential channels. So we've consumed most of the analog channels on this instrument, and we still haven't measured, we still haven't run the heater for this to make accurate measurements that need to be heated. So now we have H for the heater, and that's two more down here in 12 volts and ground. That's what it takes to connect one of these instruments to the CR1000. Because of that extensive network of wires and the complexity of users getting all those hooked up right and all the calibration factors, Apogee went to an SDI-12 output for this sensor, in which all of the A to D conversion is done here in the center in the head. What does that look like? One wire with three subcomponents. Let's take a look at where those go. Here's a new, oops, I'm going the wrong way. Here's a new version of this. The Apogee takes up one COM port, one 12 volt, and then one ground. That's it. All the calculations are done here, and it still has individual outputs for the four components. That's a big advance. It makes the wiring simpler and greatly enhances the user interface. Now, it doesn't stop there, because for precise measurements, you want heated sensors. Apogee has tiny heaters. Because it's small, the heaters only need to be tiny to keep frost off of this, to keep dew off of this in the summer, accurate measurements night and day. How's that look? You already got a little preview of this when I showed this, but look at this. There is the heated Apogee sensor on one of our typical winter days. It clear as a bell, excellent measurements. Oh, great, it's a heater. Doesn't that take a lot of power? Let's take a look at the power. The CNR4, which requires, here's the CNR4, here is the heaters and the fans for the CNR4. This fits on like this. How much power does this take, this combined unit? 6 watts to keep the CNR4 clear. How about the Hukseflux? This doesn't have fans, but it has heaters in here to keep frost from forming. The Hukseflux, which is the NR01, that comes in at 1.5 watts. Roughly drawn to scale here, what's the Apogee take? This small thing? 0.74 watts. This can easily be run from a solar panel in the dead of winter. These cannot, without having an enormous battery and a big solar panel. So that was another breakthrough, tiny heaters to keep this free. Here's another picture of it. Frost all over. This does not have to be heated. And that's why these insulating plastics in here to heat just the part that needs to be. So we worked hard at minimizing the power consumption of this. So the big advantages are simpler to use, fewer wires to hook up, less consumption of all the wires on your data logger. You can use those other channels to measure other things with this. Much lower power requirements and a small footprint, so it's easier to mount. And then finally, all of these are four-way net radiometers to get the best accuracy possible. In our longer video, we talk about measurements and models of net radiation. Many people try to model net radiation from a single measurement of shortwave. We show in that video and in the manuscripts that we've published on that, that the measurements are far superior to the models. The models, the best models with the best inputs, are still plus or minus 10% for the accuracy. And in the world of saving water, plus or minus 10% is a big deal. You don't want to overwater 10%, you don't want to underwater 10%. So we've done all this work to make this small and low power. How's the accuracy compare to the larger models? Let's take a look at that. We ran this instrument for 15 months, summer, winter, summer, on a weather station over alfalfa. You can tell this is Utah because of all our mountains in the background. Here is the Rolls-Royce instruments, the CNR-4 mounted right there on the panel. And if you squint, you can see at three apogees on here. They're small, so we had some bird spikes on here to keep this clean. How's the data come out after 15 months of work? Here's the reference, CNR-4. Here's the three replicate apogees. We were thrilled to see this tight line here. If you look closely at this, you can see some scatter. The CNR-4 was not heated and ventilated, so there was days with dew, which caused that to read low. So some of these data in here are caused by problems with the reference, not by the apogees. These high radiation days where there was no dew in the, all three replicate instruments lined up beautifully. That's what we've done to make this accurate for the user, is refine and refine and refine. Not only is it good out of the box, it's stable over many years. Thanks for listening. We are excited to get this in your hands for future measurements, help you make more accurate measurements. We've already had numerous instruments out with users in many places, and all the reports are terrific, and people have been excited to know when it became available. We hope you can purchase one soon.